I want you to take your Bibles and open to Colossians chapter 1. I was about to say we're in the middle of a series, but I don't think we are. I texted Chris and said, what am I supposed to preach on? He went, you're on your own, buddy. So, Colossians chapter 1. Begin verse 3. We always thank God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ when we pray for you, because we've heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love you have for all the saints, the faith and love that spring from the hope that's stored up for you in heaven, and that you've already heard about in the word of truth, the gospel that's come to you. All over the world, this gospel is bearing fruit and growing, just as it's been doing among you since the day you heard it and understood God's grace and all its truth. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who's a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we've not stopped praying for you and asking God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. The Lord teach us from your word, teach us how we might follow you, how we might experience your love and care and grace in fresh ways, and teach us how we might grow to be the men and women that you always intended us to be. That's our need today, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I picked this passage because it's kind of to me, a reminder of going back to what's most important. I've always looked at it and thought, this is a call to the essentials of what God wants to have happen in us. And so, as we're in this new year and new experience in life, I thought let's look at this in a fresh way. So just to let you know, ramp you up a little bit, the town of Colossae, which is where the Christians were that Paul was writing to these people, had at one time been a prosperous community, and they had money and trade and jobs and foot traffic and all these things. They were kind of like Northgate Mall at one time, you know. And before Macy's was sold and everything. Anyway, but the trade routes changed and the highway system was redesigned and Colossae was bypassed. Nobody was stopping in anymore. And jobs went away, the economy struggled, people lost their incomes, there wasn't new people coming in. And they found themselves being a place that used to be important, but it isn't anymore. And so if you were in a situation like that, you know, Seattle got bypassed for Tacoma, you know, or something like that, what would you do? What they did was historians tell us, what they did was they felt powerless, they felt like they were out of control, things weren't working, and they developed something called the Colossian heresy, which was kind of a belief system that was a smattering of kind of a little bit of this and that from different religious traditions, and a little bit of Cajun seasoning, you know, in the stew, and they're mixing us all up, and they put together a kind of a belief system that would help them feel more in control. It would help them feel like they had the power to get through the problems that they were enduring. And some of it was angel worship and things. It was kind of like walking into a New Age store or something now. You know, it's kind of like that sort of thing. It was the Colossian heresy. And now, Paul knew about it, and this letter, scholars tell us, is designed to counter that. Except that Paul's doing a brilliant thing here. He's not naming it, and he's not attacking them, which is really interesting. He's not saying, I'm writing you because there's some problems here, and your beliefs are kind of screwy, and da-da-da-da. I know you're insecure, but don't do that. Yeah, he's not doing that. Instead, what do we find him doing? He's affirming them. He's encouraging them. And he's calling out the best in them. And he's reminding them of what's most important. Even knowing that they're kind of a little screwy right now. But they're still loving them and reminding them of who they are and who God is and how this could all work together. So he writes to encourage them. He doesn't blast them. And he tells them, it's an interesting thing, he tells them what he's praying for them. You ever had anybody pray for you? Well, some of you just did this morning. I get nervous when someone comes up to me and says, I want to pray for you, John. You know, why don't you share some really, really bad things that I could pray for? Sometimes I feel like in the church, you know, prayer is just another word for gossip, you know, and how quickly it turns. And so usually I'm with the, I'm okay, you're okay, it's okay. But there's something that makes me nervous when somebody wants to pray for me. But if somebody doesn't ask and they come up and say, here's what I've been praying for you, that makes me sit up a little. And I go, oh, they cared enough to kind of look at my life and say, Lord, what's it? We need so much, Lord. It's obvious, you know. But that to me is very touching because they tell me what God's put on their heart to pray for me instead of me making the list for them. So Paul tells them, here's what we're praying for you. And whenever I think of that, I think that's telling them, pay attention, this is what's really important. Don't forget this. And so he tells them, this is what we've been praying for you. Since the day we've heard about you, we've not stopped praying for you. And asking God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. First thing we're praying for, that you have this knowledge of God and his will for you, and you'd understand that. Now, most of my ministry, I've struggled with the tension between sort of the pastor side and the psychology side. You know, should we focus on the knowledge of God, getting to know God, or should we get to know people and figure out what makes us tick ourselves, and, you know, and I've always had that kind of tension, and I've told you this before, I loved John Calvin, who's brilliant, he was a French Catholic lawyer, and yet we still read his stuff, and when he was about 19, he had his first draft of the Institutes of the Christian Religion. And in it, he starts out with, do we look at the to gain a knowledge of God or a knowledge of people? And he said, it does not matter one bit. It doesn't matter where you start. If you, the more you know about God, the more it will lead you to understand yourself and the people around you. The more you learn about people and yourself and what makes you tick, the more you are just drawn to wanting to know God. He said, it works together. And I really love that. I love that insight because it reminds me that God's in the whole picture, in the whole deal. And in fact, here's what John Calvin says. Each of us must be so stung by the consciousness of our own unhappiness as to obtain at least some knowledge of God. When we come to grips with our lives and what's happening in it and some of the disappointments and losses accumulated along the ways, we are just magnetically pulled to want to know God. As long as we're happy and we're blissful and everything's great, you know, like my life usually is. As long as that happens, we don't really need to know much about God. But when we're aware of what's really happening and we come to grips with it, we're drawn to God. So then, this is what he says. Thus, from the feeling of our own ignorance, vanity, poverty, infirmity, and what's more, our depravity and corruption, we recognize the full abundance of every good and the righteousness that rests in the Lord alone. See, when we come to grips with our own needs, with our own sickness, with our own distractions, it pulls us to want to know God, to grow in our knowledge of Him. And then he says this, to this extent, we are prompted by our own ills to contemplate the good things of God. And we cannot seriously aspire to Him before we begin to become displeased with ourselves. The two go hand in hand. And so if we come to grips with our life, who we are, and we start to see the shadowy places as well as the celebrations, that we can't help but seek knowledge of the living God. And that was Paul's prayer for the Christians in Colossae who were feeling left behind by life and deserted and all those things and weak and powerless. He said, you need to know God more. You need to know God and come to understand His incredible love and power and presence available for you and how God sees you. Don't see yourself the way your parents might have seen you. Please, see yourself the way God sees you, the object of His love and His care. So that's the beginning of Paul's prayer, that you would grow in your knowledge of God with understanding, right?
Is that what it says?
You may have the Bible, sir. The knowledge of His will through all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And the understanding is that, you know, it's the application of what we know. So it's not enough just to say, okay, I know a lot about God, that's good. You know, it's like, well, how do we apply that in our lives? How do we live out the implications of God's will for us and how He treats us and how He loves us? That's where the understanding comes in, that we see that there's a an impact on us, and also an impact on our world through us, as we come to understand what God has in store for us. Now, if I was a graphic guy, I would just point at the screen, and you know, some words would pop up and stuff. But I don't know how to do that yet, so that'll come in another day. But so I want you to picture a circle here, okay, up on the screen. Well, you could picture it on this screen, but this isn't as good a screen. This is the better one because I'm left-handed. So up at the top, the first part of the dream is this knowledge of God, right? That we grow in our knowledge. The second part of it is with understanding, right? So we start with our knowledge of God growing, and then His prayer is that this would happen with understanding, that we're able to apply what we're discovering, what we're learning, and it starts to impact our life. The third part of this is that it begins to be put into action. So with knowledge, understanding, now down to action. Are you following the high scale graphic here? Okay.
I know you're looking, I don't see that.
That you would live lives worthy. That your lives would reflect the worthiness, the value of God's love and care in you. And that would begin to be lived out. And over the last couple of years, one of the questions that keeps coming up is, so how do we live differently because of our relationship with Christ? And I think that's a really key question to ask, right? For each one of us, in our work, in our retirement, in our education, in our play, whatever we do, in our relationships, how do we live lives that are worthy? Well, it begins with our knowledge of God and understanding of what He wants for us, and then it begins to permeate our actions. And it's very much like this. I think this is the Holy Spirit. It couldn't be messing with me.
I can't believe it.
So you have knowledge, understanding. Knowledge, understanding. They are messing with me. So, and then you get over to fruitfulness.
That our lives would be fruitful, that it would bear fruit, that there would be evidence of God's grace in us. And then finally, growth. Now, over the decades, you know, people who come to me for counseling, they always want to know, okay, what do I need to know to grow? They want to go from the knowledge to the growth and skip everything in the middle, right? Which makes going to counseling with me a painful experience. That's why I was accused at University Press of having a hydraulic butt-kicking machine in the office. It wasn't true, okay? That was just a rumor, but it felt like it to some people, because you got to go from knowledge to understanding to living a life worthy of action and fruitfulness, and then the growth is apparent. You can't skip that.
It all works around like that.
So, that's his prayer. That's his prayer for them. I'm thinking, if that was his prayer for us, if that's what God wants to have happen in us, how do we respond to that? How do we receive what he has for us? To quote Calvin, or paraphrase Calvin, really, because who knows if I'm really quoting him, I don't do French very well, but our knowledge of God, our knowledge of ourselves, they're linked together, and when we come to grips with our struggles, then we are drawn more to God and our need for his love and grace, which then we begin to understand, which we put into practice, and then our lives become fruitful in ministry and care, and then we begin to grow, right? So looking back, you know, I've been a minister way too long, but the thing is, there have been some shifts in the way churches approach ministry Christian over the year, right? So, used to be, three years ago, when I was in college, you know, they had a thing called the Four Spiritual Laws, Campus Crusade distributed. And I went, not door to door, but table to table in the cafeterias and shared these. They're helpful. It began with, God loves you, and all this, but it really gets down to, we're sinful and we're separated from God. And then there was like this chasm and a little bridge you had to go across and all this thing in the drawings. And I always looked at that, and I'd be sharing along, God loves you, has a plan for your life, blah, blah, blah. And people are saying, oh, that's interesting, you know. And then you go, and you're sinful and separated from God. And then some go, yeah, you're right. Oh, am I? Anything can happen, you know, and then some of them say, hey, I want Jesus in my life because I know what a mess I've made of things. I go, woo-hoo. Some people go, what are you talking about? You don't even know me. Well, I was just guessing. I went to order for lunch. but that idea of people have to come to grips with their sinfulness. And the other side of that, which is the need for forgiveness, and we talk about that all the time, right? That we need to be forgiven, and it gives us a fresh start, and all those things. But there was a shift in Christianity somewhere along the line, and we started using words like, instead of saying you're a sinner, get used to it, you know, that kind of thing. We shifted to, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? I was grateful for that, because that was a lot easier to sell. You know, would you like to have a relationship with Jesus? You know, is Jesus your friend? You know, and both sides are true. That's the funny thing. They're both true. They're both sides of the gospel. And they each have their own music. You know, one is, well, I'm a friend, we have a Jesus, right? Isn't that cool? We love that. Of course, then they sneak in the second line, which nobody ever does. All our sins and griefs to bear. That's not so happy, no. But that is the song, right? Both sides. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. What's the next part? That saved a wretch like me. You know, those are two parts of the gospel. And we need to recognize that and understand that they do go together. It's not one or the other. Although some days you'd prefer one over the other, honestly. I wish I didn't need grace. I wish I didn't need forgiveness so often, but I do. Glad that Jesus is my friend, but you know, even friends will talk back sometimes and say, what are you doing, Westfall? That was a couple of Westfall. Jesus does too. What are you doing? What were you thinking there? That's what friends do, right? They don't just go, oh, good for you, good for you. Because that would be superficial and shallow. And Jesus doesn't want to be our superficial friend. He wants to be intimately engaged in our life. Because he loves us so much that he's not going to let us flip around. He wants to go deep. So we start with our knowledge of God, understanding, begin to live a life worthy, putting into action, fruitfulness, and then growth, which leads to more knowledge of God, and the circle continues and continues. Now, when I think about us, it's amazing how complex we can be, right, in our lives. We're not just simple people. It's easier to preach if you were, but you're not. You're smart and complex and questioning things all the time. So, who are we? And what does Jesus want to do in us? Today, as we come to the table, the communion table we do every month, and we take this bread, this body broken for us, and we take the cup of forgiveness, right? Say, come into my life anew. What needs to happen? I think we need to let him come into our whole life. C.S. Lewis, a lot of people quote, usually from Language and the Wardrobe, but... his salvation story was, I got on my motorcycle one day and I drove to the zoo. And when I got off the motorcycle, I was a Christian. That's a testimony that doesn't make any sense. That's how he described it. I got on my motorcycle, I drove to the zoo, I got off my motorcycle, and I was a Christian. Something had happened. God did something in me. I can't explain it other than when I got off the motorcycle at the zoo, I was different. Isn't that great? That's cool. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, during Hitler's rule, just before he was put to death in prison, just as the prison was being freed, he writes this in Letters from Prison. Who am I? They often tell me I could step from my cell's confinement calmly, cheerfully, firmly, like a squire from his country house. Who am I? They often tell me I walk to my wardens freely, friendly, and clearly, as though they were mine to command. Who am I? They also tell me I could bear the day's misfortune, smilingly, proudly, like one accustomed to win. Am I then really all that which others tell of? Or am I only what I know of myself, restless and longing and sick, like a bird in a cage struggling for breath as though hands were compressing my throat, yearning for colors, for flowers, for the voice of birds, for thirsting for words of kindness, for neighborliness, trembling with anger at despots and petty humiliation, tossing in expectation of great events, and powerlessly trembling for friends at an infinite distance, weary and empty at praying, thinking, at making faint and ready to say farewell to it all. Who am I? This or the other? Am I one person today and tomorrow another? Am I both at once, A hypocrite before others and before myself, a contemptible, woebegone weakling? Or is something within me still like a beaten army fleeing in disorder from victories that have already been achieved? Who am I? Who are you? Are you this? Are you that? Are you confident, serene, in control? Or are you struggling and you can't hardly breathe? The pain's too great. The burden's too much. It doesn't matter who you are. It matters that God knows you and loves you and values you and cares for you and wants you to understand that and experience it, living it out in fruitfulness and growth. That's what he wants for you, whoever you are.